Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for our leaders meeting tonight. Thank you for the way you are protecting your people. Thank you for the love you've given us to keep on serving you. And thank you for the fruit we're bearing already. We're praying, O Lord, that you help us so that we'll bear more fruit in Jesus' name. Speak to us tonight and use us to do exploits for you. In Jesus' name, we pray. We're grateful to the Lord for the privilege of serving him and for the great work he has committed into our hands. Already you know that we've just finished our workers' retreat, and we add the second chance for those who are not able to attend at all, or those who are not able to attend fully. We had that second chance for them last weekend, and we appreciate the response of those who have now made use of that second chance, and the Lord has taught us quite a lot. And with what the Lord is doing in our midst already, touching our hearts and making us to reconsecrate and rededicate ourselves to the service of the Lord, we've been following through on the way the Lord has been leading us during the workers' retreat. And I've spoken already in the Sunday service on the excellent way of love. And I pointed out that if we're going to do the work of the Lord, or build the church, or raise our families, or live the best life we can live, and the way we treat our friends, and the way we even treat our enemies, and receive the greatest reward, the excellent way of doing that is through love. And I still want to move on and follow through on that thought and the teaching of Scripture. So at this time, I'm talking on the ministry of love in the body. The ministry of love in the body. As you know, the church is referred to as the body of Christ. And when Christ ministered here on earth, he ministered in love. And as Christ ministers through his ministers, his servants now, he still wants to continue ministering in love. The ministry of love then is to continue in the body, to the body, and by the body. Everyone in the body of Christ is both to minister and to be ministered to in love. In Romans chapter 12, reading from verse 4. Romans 12, reading from verse 4. For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we, being many, are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministry, or he that teacheth on teaching, or he that exhorteth on exhortation, he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity, he that ruleth with diligence, he that showeth mercy with cheerfulness. Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil, cleave to that which is good. Be kindly affectioned one to another with brotherly love, in honor preferring one another. You see very clearly in the verses I've read, it's talking about the body of Christ, and talking about all the members, and in fact all the ministers too, in that body of Christ. Because in verses 6, 7, and 8, he mentions the various areas of ministry. Our ministries, according to our gifts, differ one from the other. And yet, the bottom line of everything is that love will continue. And in verse 9, that kind of love should be without insincerity, which means it should be sincere. It should be without any pretense, which means that we should be honest along with that love. And then it goes on that we are kindly affectioned one to another with brotherly love. In honor, we prefer one another. As we minister then in the body of Christ, love should go before the ministry, and love should go along with the ministry, and love should still follow through and follow after that ministry. It's very important as we now minister with renewed zeal, with renewed consecration and renewed decision, dedication, that we're really going to serve the Lord. In verse 15, it says, rejoice with them that do rejoice, weep with them that weep. In our ministry, there should be both sympathy and empathy. That is, we're able to stand where the people stand, go through what they are going through, and empathize with them, and put ourselves in our positions. When they hurt, we hurt with them. When they are happy, we're happy with them. And we're not just happy internally or just hurt internally. We show it, we reflect it in our messages, we show it in our actions, we show it in our dealing with the members, we show it in everything that we do. And then it says, be of the same mind one to another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. We don't look down on people. If people are down, we get down with them, come to their level, and show that we can identify with them. It says, be not wise in your own conceits. Recompense to no man evil for evil, obviously. As we minister to the people of God, it may be that unconsciously, carelessly, some of them might have hurt us one way or the other. But then we do not recompense to anyone in the membership, anyone among our colleagues that we're serving together. We don't recompense evil for evil, and we provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lies in you, live peaceably with all men. We shouldn't raise up conflict in the district, and we should let the sleeping dog lie. And instead of acting as if we enjoy conflict and enjoy problems and we don't mind at all whether there are problems at all, we shouldn't act in that way. As much as it's possible, we live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, in verse 19, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. That means we can melt the hard hearts of other people, even those who have determined that they're not going to listen to us, they're not going to cooperate with us as we minister to them, or as we want them to minister along with us in the ministry. We can melt their hearts with coals of fire, and it's a fire of love. Be not overcome of evil. That means if negative things are happening, don't let those negative things overcome you. In the ministry, as you minister in the church, as you do this and do that, there'll be some things that you consider not quite all right. They hurt you. You may consider them evil. Don't allow those evil things, those wrong things, those negative things, we should say, to affect you and overcome you. But overcome those evil things, those negative things, those things you judge not to be all right, overcome them with good. That's to be the posture of the minister, the posture of those who are serving and those who are leading. I want to touch on 3 points. Number one, love from ministers. Obviously, if there's anyone that should show the example, be the model of love, it should be the ministers. Number two, love among the members. The way we minister will make them to see that we're showing the model, the example of love. And it will spill over to the members. Once we begin to show the love and reflect that love and speak in love, we'll still maintain the truth, we'll still maintain sound doctrine, but we're speaking that truth and giving out that sound doctrine, we're doing it in love. Then number three is love towards ministers. Number one, love from ministers. I want to read from 1 Samuel chapter 30, reading from verse 1. 1 Samuel chapter 30 verse 1. And it came to pass, when David and his men were come to Ziklag on the third day, that the Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag, and smitten Ziklag, and burnt it with fire, and had taken the women captives that were therein. They slew not any, either great or small, but carried them away and went on their way. So David and his men came to the city, and behold, It was burnt with fire, and their wives and their sons and their daughters were taken captives. Then David and the people that were with him lifted up their voice and wept until they had no more power to weep. And David's two wives were taken captives, Ahinoam, the Jezreelites, and Abigail, the wife of Nabal, the Carmelite. And David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and for his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. Well, the story I'm reading to you may not be strange to you. Many of us reading the Bible, you've read this before. But I want you to look at it now from the angle of leadership. David was a leader, and he was a king. He was a leader of no mean value. He had been anointed, although he had not fully taken the throne, because Saul was still alive. But even though he was not sitting on the throne, you know that he had some men that were with him. We just read about them. And these hundreds of people following after him, he was their leader. But something happened. It was a kind of a common calamity that came on them. But it struck David. The blow was much on David. One, David had lost much. His two wives were taken captives. The property had gone. And then not only that, his companions, the team leaders, the supportive ministers, they too, they had lost much. Because we are told in verse 6, their sons and their daughters had been taken. Of course, their wives too had been taken captives, and the property had been lost too. Not only that, their families were under oppression now, great captivity, discouragement and distress had set in. And these giant killers, come to think about it, they wept, and they wept like nobody could comfort them. David himself wept, and the other people wept, which means they were overcome by their sorrows. It's like life had come to an end, ministry had come to an end. But I want to show you something. In the midst of this distress, in the midst of this problem, it was love from David, the leader, and from his men to an insignificant person that made them to recover all. The point of the story is very clear, that even though you as a leader, you may have some few problems or even great problems, personal problems, family problems, but you know, if we think about all those things, we'll drown ourselves in the sea of self-pity. See what I'm going through. See what is happening to me. See what I've lost. See the gang up against me. See this and see that. If we remain like that, we'll forget to love anybody. But please understand, whatever is happening to you, whatever is happening to me, whatever is happening to us, the way we're going to recover everything, and the way we're going to bring the church, the ministry, the district back to where it was before and beyond where it was before, is still through the ministry of love. Please read with me as we look at it from verse 10. But David pursued, he and 400 men, those were people under his leadership, for 200 abode behind, which were so faint that could not go over the brook bosom. You see, the 200 of the people, the leadership with him, they were so faint, discouraged, faint, tired, lost everything, that they couldn't even raise their hand or even walk any distance. They just stayed where they were. In verse 11, and they found an Egyptian in the field and brought him to David, and gave him bread, and he did eat, and they made him drink water. Can you still show mercy to anybody when nobody has shown mercy to you? Can you still smile and take care of members in the district when your own problems are overwhelming you? When you've just wept and there was nobody to comfort you, and you are thinking, how are you going to recover everything that you have lost? Do you know that it is by showing love to somebody that may not even be very significant, that will bring you back to where you ought to be? It says in verse 12, and they gave him a piece of cake of figs and two clusters of raisins. And when he had eaten, his spirit came again to him, for he had eaten no bread, nor drunk any water, 3 days and 3 nights. And David said to him, To whom belongest thou? And whence art thou? And he said, I'm a young man of Egypt, servant to an Amalekite, and my master left me because 3 days are gone. I felt sick. We made an invasion upon the south of the Seretites, and upon the coast which belonged to Judah, and upon the south of Caleb, and we burnt Ziklag with fire. And David said to him, Canst thou bring me down to this company? And he said, Swear unto me by God, that thou wilt neither kill me nor deliver me into the hands of my master, and I will bring thee down to this company. And when he had brought him down, behold, they were spread abroad upon all the earth, eating and drinking and dancing, because of all the great spoil that they had taken out of the land of the Philistines and out of the land of Judah. And David smote them from the twilight even unto the evening of the next day, and there escaped not a man of them, save 400 young men which rode upon camels and fled. Look at verse 18. And David recovered all that the Amalekites had carried away. Then in verse 20 it says, David took all the flocks and the herds which they drave before those other cattle, and said, This is David's spoil. The point is this, that it was by this minister, this David, this anointed one, showing mercy and love to this insignificant stranger, that made him to recover everything that he lost before. The point is this: if we just remain in our sorrows and our problems, and keep on talking about the problems we face in the ministry, expanding it and complaining and grinding and whining, whatever, we're not going to get back to the glory that God wants us to get back to. And the way the Lord has been dealing with us from the time of this last workers retreat is just that we forgive everyone, we forget everything, we move on in love. And as we move on in love, then the work will be done. And we ourselves will be able to recover whatever it is that we have lost. That's the reason we're looking at this, that we as ministers, in whatever level, whatever height we have reached, whatever level of leadership, the thing to do is to make sure that we keep on loving one another. In fact, we should love more than ever before. You see the example and the model we've seen in David, and that's the thing that made him to recover everything that he lost before. In every district, I'm appealing to our coordinators, our women coordinators, our zonal leaders and women reps, and all our workers too, that please go back to the district. Forget the injury, forget the hurt, and forget, this not cooperating, this one is not doing well and all that, and just lavish the love of God upon those people. Of course, you are still going to maintain the truth. You are still going to preach the word of God. You will not decrease from the truth you have been preaching, but you now speak the truth in love. Care for the people. Take care of the physical needs they have, the physical problems they have. And as you do that, the Lord himself will use that channel of love, that instrument and tool of love, and bring everything back to where it ought to be. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, reading from verse 7. But we were gentle among you, even as a nurse cherishes her children. Here was Paul the apostle talking. And if you know anything about Paul the apostle, he was a strong man, a man of strong constitution. He was a man that could, get through shipwreck and still keep on preaching. He was a man that, could be beaten and whipped and still keep on preaching. He was a man that, he didn't have any feeling of any suffering, even though the sufferings were there. But, a person like that, sometimes when you are strong physically, strong emotionally, and strong in your constitution, sometimes you can deal with people with the strength that you have. After all, even when you're sick, you don't feel it too much. So when other people are sick, you may not feel it too. But Paul the apostle, as strong as he was, still said, were gentle among you. The gentleness of a nursing mother over weak, frail babies. And that's the way we should act in the district. You are gentle, even if you are strong within, things don't affect you, you don't care what they do, still please be gentle as a nurse cherishes her children. So, in verse 8, being affectionately desirous of you, we were willing to have imparted unto you not the gospel of God only, but also our own souls, because ye were dear unto us. Do you see that language? Ye were dear unto us. Make every member to be dear unto you. And no matter what you are going through, no matter the persecution, no matter the pain, when somebody comes before you, treat that person as the most important person on earth. Why? Well, because that's the way the person feels. He feels he's the most important person on earth, at least to himself. He's precious to himself. Treat him the way he would treat himself. The way he feels precious, the way he feels significant, treat him that way. Oh, it's a sister. Maybe she has some problems, and you even know some things about her, but she still feels, you know, she's worth, you know, a human being, a real child of God, and she doesn't know her own frailties and her own weaknesses and her own shortcomings and problems. She doesn't depreciate herself just because of those problems. She wants to feel significant. Treat her that way, because ye were dear unto us. So treat everyone as if they were really dear unto you. They are dear unto God, they should be dear to you. They are dear unto Christ, they should be dear to you. They are precious to the Lord, and he gave his blood to redeem them. So that's the way to act to the people, so that as we show that love, then we'll be able to minister in an acceptable way in the house of God. In John chapter 13, reading from verse 13, ye call me Master and Lord, and ye say well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. Jesus laid the example, and that's the best way to actually carry people along. You lay the example down. And Jesus said, now you among leaders, even among yourselves, that's how to do to one another, wash one another's feet. Let's understand that, you know, all of us coordinators, we're colleagues. All of us zonal leaders, we're colleagues. And you treat one another in a respectable manner. The respect you want the other zonal leader to give to you, you give to him. And youth leaders, children, church workers, campus workers, the various sections, let's show that love to one another, accommodating one another. If the feet are dirty, oh, don't complain about that. Just get water and see how to wash one another's feet. Don't hurt their feet, but see how to wash one another's feet. So we need to manifest love towards the members of the church. That's point number one, love from ministers. Point number two, love among the members. Actually, what you see among the membership will be the reflection of what we ministers are doing. Because if we are harsh, do you know what will happen? The members will just learn from us unconsciously. Day to day will be harsh. If we at the pulpit, if we are inconsiderate, you'll be surprised. Without telling the members to be inconsiderate, day to day are going to be inconsiderate of one another. They speak our language. They manifest our attitude, and they take our posture. That's the reason why our showing love, it's not just so that the church will grow. Of course, the church will grow. It's also so that we can be good examples and models to the people. The thing we want to see in the membership. Let us start that same thing, and they will reflect that same thing. Love among the members. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 from verse 25. That there be no schism, no division, no disagreement, no discord in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another. That the members of the church, they'll show that same love among one another, and then among the others, and then there'll be care one to the other. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it, or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. If we show this love to the membership will pick it up too. And we will not have to, you know, drag our members, push our members, threaten our members, rebuke our members before they can show love. You know, all the rebuke, we don't love one another. You members, you are not visiting one another. You members, you are not doing the right thing. The Bible says we should love. If you say you are Christians, why are you not loving? You know, all that driving and forcing and coercing and complaining will not make the members to love one another. We read the scriptures to them, and we read those scriptures even in our tone. There should be that love there. There should be that care. There should be that understanding there. There should be that gentleness there. And then as we reflect that love from us to them, they too, they reflect it back to us and reflect it back to one another. So the point is, as we care, they too, they will care. And they have to care, because that's what the Lord has given to the membership of the church, love one another. In John chapter 13, John 13, 34, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another, as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. That ye also love one another. I'm sure you've read this before. Jesus was talking to his own disciples. It's actually those that became apostles. And he was telling them they should show the love. Do you see here? It says that ye love one another. You think about Peter, James, John, Matthew, and the rest of the apostles. Jesus said that you love one another. But Peter is strong. Does he need love? And John, you know, resting at the bosom of Jesus, does John need love? And James, does James need love? Since these are apostles, and they love God, and God loves them, and they know the scriptures, and they have faith, and what do they need that Jesus will not supply? You know, sometimes we think that even we who are leaders among ourselves, we don't know that we need love. And one coordinator to the other, and one group coordinator to the other group coordinator, or to the other coordinators, one preacher to the other preacher. But you know, Jesus said that these preachers, these apostles, they should love one another. Have you ever considered this verse 34, that Jesus was talking to apostles, and then he still said they should love one another? We who are workers, here we are this evening in the leadership, in the leaders meeting. Do you know that we need to love one another and demonstrate that? It's true, we know the scriptures, but you know, there are some of us who are leaders, we are hurting one way or the other. And even though we're leaders, the Lord is still saying, let's love one another. And then it comes to the membership now. The members of the church, the Lord has said, we should love one another. Therefore, from one member to the other, it should flow freely. Pure love, fervent love, one to another. He said, as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. Then in verse 35, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, ye are members of the body of Christ, if ye have love one to another. In Romans chapter 15, Romans chapter 15, verse 7. Romans 15, verse 7. Wherefore receive ye one another, as Christ also received us to the glory of God. Receive ye one another. That's part of it. Sometimes, you know, when we approach one another, you can know whether we want to receive you or not. Our appearance, our demeanor, our attitude, our look, everything around us, we should be approachable. And our members too, we should receive one another. That's how we actually show the love. It's not just in the words we speak, and it's not just in the material things we give out, our attitude to one another, our receptivity, our interaction. All those things can demonstrate whether that love is there or not. And even though we're talking about love among the members, but you know, we who are preachers, we are members of the church too. Women coordinators, although we have office and we have privilege to serve, we are members too. The coordinator should receive the women coordinator, and you grant her the respect that, you know, she deserves, her office deserves. And the zonal leaders, you should receive them. We shouldn't feel we're so high there. And when these other workers, leaders who are working among us and working along with us, when they come, we're not able to receive them, Let them feel welcome. Let them feel that they are significant. Let them feel that what they have to say, whatever it is, you want to hear, you want to listen. And then let that be reflected in the membership too. In Galatians chapter 6, Galatians chapter 6, verse 2, bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. We bear one another's burdens. Of course, you may have your own burdens that you are carrying, but you still have time, and you still have the heart the broad heart, the loving heart, to be able to bear the burdens of others. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32, and be kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you. There are some of us, we act as if we can only get along if we don't offend one another. But it says Christ has forgiven us, and therefore we forgive one another. Let's teach our membership. And you know, if we're going to teach our membership that they should forgive one another, they want to see it reflected in also in the leadership too. Forgive one another, forgive the members in the church. You know, they are going to know whether you forgive or not if you don't keep on talking about the offenses of the members every time. Give them time. Maybe not everything is corrected yet in your district church. Give them time. Show that you are forgiving them. And if something else happens, don't bring back again, you know, the remembrance of, you know, what we said before, you know what you did before. Even though I've forgiven you, but you know what's still happening now. Let's bury all that. Let's show in practical terms that you're forgiving them, and then they'll be able to forgive one another. Be kind one to the other. And in 1 Peter chapter 4, 1 Peter chapter 4, 1 Peter chapter 4, reading from verse 8. 1 Peter 4 verse 8, and above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves. To the members of the church, here is Peter talking by the Spirit of God. Have charity, that's love, not just love, but fervent love that you can demonstrate. That somebody will know, it looks like that other member looks like they love me now, looks like they appreciate me now, looks like they welcome me now, it looks like I wanted to leave this district before, but it looks like the way the people are acting, they don't want me to leave the district. It looks like they are healing my hurts because of the way they are showing love to me. For charity shall cover the multitude of sins. Use hospitality one to another without grudging. Love actually heals us, and love feeds us, and love builds us up. If you've experienced it before, how love just satisfies your heart and satisfies your life and makes us feel like we're accepted. Love makes us to do and makes us to produce our best. If you want somebody to actually produce, or you want her to do something to the level of your expectation, that the person might even outdo himself, just love him. Because once love heals the wounds and strengthens the weakness, you'll find that the people will work much more than they could ever work before. So let's do that every time, and let's show that by the grace of God, the work will go on as we make the members to love one another. Then we come to point number three, love towards ministers. Now, here is something that maybe we don't even think about, that the membership of the church, they ought to show love to the ministers too. And it's sometimes difficult because you as a coordinator, you don't want to talk to the people that they ought to love you. But well, the Bible is complete as love goes to the members from the ministers. And the members are loving one another, members to members. So the love ought to flow back from the members to the ministers too. Actually, if this does not happen, the church will not get to the place the church ought to get to. Look at this story in Exodus chapter 17. Exodus chapter 17 from verse 8. Then came Amalek and fought with Israel in Rephidim. And Moses said unto Joshua, choose us out men, and go out, fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in mine hand. So Joshua did as Moses had said to him, and fought with Amalek. And Moses and Aaron and all went up to the top of the hill. And it came to pass, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. Stop there for a moment. You know the story, but let's learn something here. Amalek was fighting with Israel, and Joshua needed to go forth with some soldiers and fight against Amalek. Now, we're told in verse 11, it came to pass, it so happened, when Moses held up his hand, Israel prevailed. When he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. The Lord wants us to see the interrelationship, interdependence among the workers, the members, the soldiers, Joshua, Moses, Aaron, and all. We might say that Joshua was a kind of a militant, accomplished, a well-trained captain. Yes, he was. At least you can see here. And then if you go to the book of Joshua, you can see that too. We can say that the soldiers were very faithful. They were very committed. They were orderly. They knew what to do. And they could really fight. Yes, we can say that. You can see that because there are times they prevailed. We can say that the position of Moses was very, very significant because he went to the mountaintop. And when he was there on the mountaintop, if he stretched up his hand, the rod of the Lord in his hand, then Joshua prevailed. And you know that Moses was a great leader. But then you see Aaron and all, that they had to support the ministry, the holding up of the hand of Moses. Do you see the interdependence? Do you know that even if you are the Joshua, no matter how strong you are, how skilled you are, how capable you are, how committed, consecrated you are, you need a Moses to raise up his hand of intercession. And then it's while he's raising up his hand of intercession that your skill, your ability will achieve what he thought to achieve. But do you know that even Moses, even though he had power, he had authority, he knew what to do, his hands became weak. He needed Aaron and Ur, that they will lift up his hand, they will support his hand of intercession. Do you see the importance there? That the connection between Moses, Aaron and Ur, and Joshua and the soldiers that were fighting. That's the reason why we need to show love to the ministers, the members of the church, the workers. We need to support the coordinators. We need to support the women coordinators. We're not going to move ahead. We're not going to do much. We're not going to win the victory for the whole of Israel, for the church of the living God, for the church, for the whole church as a whole, or for the church even in your district, if we are pulling down one another, destroying one another, criticizing one another. Let all the other workers support the coordinators. Let the other workers support the women coordinators. Let the coordinators love the membership and love the workers. Let the workers and the members also love the leadership in that local church and in the central church and in the whole city and in the whole nation. And that's the way to do it, because that is what will give us the victory that we need. Look at verse 12. But Moses' hands were heavy, and he took a stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and Ur stayed up his hands, the one on the one side, the other on the other side. And his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. Now, if you have read about the life of Moses, and I'm sure you have, and you see a person that had been in the presence of Almighty God, and eventually in the later chapters, his face even shone with the glory of the Lord when he came back from the mountain. And you see his knowledge, you see all the revelations he had as he wrote all these books of the Pentateuch. You'll think this is a leader that he doesn't need anybody's support, anybody's love, anybody's encouragement. But Moses needed Aaron and Ur to stay up his hands so that Joshua will keep on winning the victory. The point is very clear that the leaders need the love of the members. They need the support. We shouldn't be criticizing the leaders, finding fault with the leaders, writing petition against the leaders. We need to support them. It's as we support them, no criticism, no cutting down, no critical judgmental attitude. Even if a leader, you know, is not measuring up the way you want him to measure up, your love will build him up and make him to produce more and to do more than he could do ordinarily. And Joshua discomfited this, verse 13, Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. Let's just stop there and go to another passage in 2 Kings chapter 4, reading from verse 8. I'm talking on this important part of love towards ministers. 2 Kings chapter 4 verse 8, and it fell on a day that Elisha passed to Shunem, where was a great woman, and she constrained him to eat bread. And so it was that as oft as he passed by, he turned him thither to eat bread. And she said to her husband, Behold, now I perceive that this is an holy man of God, which passes by us continually. Let us make a little chamber, I pray thee, on the wall. That is, beside the wall. That's just a location there. And let us set for him there a bed, and a table, and a stool, and a candlestick. And it shall be, when he cometh to us, that he shall turn in thither. And it fell on a day that he came thither, and he turned into the chamber and lay there. You see here, this woman showed love to the man of God, to Elisha. Elisha, although he had a double portion of the Spirit of God, and he had a great ministry, and he was actually carrying on the ministry. You can see he was a very active person, because he said he often passed by us here, and he's been doing the work. And then he will turn in, they give him a food, he will eat bread. And that's what the love they were showing to him. Until the woman now told the husband, why don't we make a permanent kind of accommodation arrangement for this man as he's passing by here? Do you know sometimes that we can do that? Do you know sometimes we don't have to wait for, you know, the whole church, the central church, before we can do that? In fact, sometimes we might, do you know, we have some workers, like full-time workers, and once in a while we have some members showing love to some of our full-time workers, some of our leaders. Sometimes it gladdens my heart. It doesn't happen, you know, too often, but once in a while that a worker will tell me that, praise the Lord, somebody just bought a vehicle and they bought it in his name and just gave it to him, appreciating the work that person is doing for the Lord. It happens once in a while, and how I wish that happens more often. May not be a car, maybe some other necessities of life, maybe this or that, that we're able to do. And we don't have to make announcements in the church and, you know, this person needs this and this person. There was no announcement here. And this woman said to the husband, can't we do this? And they did. See something that happened here. And then it says some in verse 12, and he said to Gehazi, his servant, call this Shunammite. And when he had called her, she stood before him. And he said unto him, say now unto her, behold, thou hast been careful for us with all this care. What is to be done for thee? Wouldest thou be spoken for to the king or to the captain of the host? And she answered, I dwell among my own people. The woman wasn't even expecting anything. And she wasn't asking for any prayer, wasn't asking for anything as such. All she wanted was just to take care of this servant of the Lord. And he said, what then is to be done for her? That's verse 14. And Gehazi answered, verily she has no child, and her husband is old. You know, sometimes in our society here, once a member of the church is, you know, she's married and she's barren, there is no child, the attitude is, you know, I don't have any child. And we carry that everywhere, and we refuse to do any good thing towards anybody. And if we hear the messages, well, praise God, we're saved and we're sanctified. Some of such members, some of them may not even react or relate in a loving manner to other people. Their burden of childlessness, barrenness, just will weigh them down, that they'll not be able to show kindness, care, love to anybody. But this woman just forgot her problem and just took care of the man of God. And this family, not having any child, see how they took care. Do you know, the great miracle you are expecting may come to you as a result of showing the love to the ministers of the gospel, to the workers in the vineyard. It says in verse 15, and he said, call her. And when he had called her, she stood in the door. There was no familiarity between her and the man of God, no sin involved here. And he said, about this season, according to the time of life, thou shalt embrace a son. And she said, nay, my lord, thou man of God, do not lie unto thy handmaid. She was saying that because the husband was very old, and probably she was old already. And the woman conceived and bare a son at that season that Elisha had said unto her, according to the time of life. The point is, show love to the ministers of the gospel, to the workers in the vineyard, and you'll discover that the great miracles you're expecting may just come your way like that. Before we close, let's look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12 and 13. And we beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you. They admonish you, they counsel you, they instruct you, they lead you in the way of the Lord, to esteem them very highly in love. Esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves. The Lord is beginning to do great things in our midst, and it will continue, and the power of God will continue to flow, and the greatness of God will continue to be manifested in our midst if love will continue. Everything is based on the love of God in the heart of the minister, in the life of the members, and as we relate to one another, let brotherly love continue. Don't let it just stop at the workers' retreat. Don't let it stop at the Sunday message that we heard last Sunday. But let us continue in the love of God. Let the ministers manifest love every time, everywhere, in every way possible. And let the members show the love one to another. Let the members also reciprocate and show love to the ministers who are laboring over us in the Lord. And the goodness of the Lord will continue with every life, and this church will be what it ought to be. Wherever you are called to serve, wherever, whether it is temporary or it is permanent, whether you are full-time or you are volunteer or you are working in the district, anywhere you are, let everything you do be done in love. And the blessings of God will be upon your service in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer, and pray that the Lord will help you to manifest more love